We're gonna show you how this stone becomes this insulation on your job site. Let's get going. All right, guys, I've got my tour guide, Justin. Justin, what happens with these raw materials?
So first they're brought in via truck and then they're weighed on our on-site scale. And then truck backs into the bay, dumps the raw material in the bay. A loader operator will come in, pick up the raw material, take it to our shaker table where it's dropped onto a conveyor and carried on to on-site storage for silos.
Justin, what's the story behind the lined ponds you guys have on your campus?
So we have two retention ponds here. It captures everything from the employee parking lot that we walk through, the retention features in the middle, and then our truck parking lot, and it retains it here for natural rainwater collection. And we use this water to supply up to 80% of the water used in our process here.
Is that right? Wow, so you're not actually pulling from the town's water supply, you're pulling from these ponds.
We do use city water, but we try to keep that to a bare minimum. Like I said, we like to supply at least 80% of the process water here with rainwater collection from the site.
That's pretty cool. All right, so the raw material comes in from the quarries, they dump it in these bins out here, and this room has a hopper with a conveyor, which is coming right up, and the first step of the process is melting those ingredients. Let's go inside and meet Justin. And Justin, where does that conveyor lead now?
So at the top of the silos here, there is a conveyor that's on a spindle essentially, and it reaches the tops of the 8 of these silos. So for each raw material that comes in, it goes to a certain silo and then that'll pivot to the next one and deposit that raw material there. And then based on the charge recipe, raw material will drop down out of these conveyors here onto a weigh conveyor where it'll pick that charge up, take it onto the shaker table, sieve it out, crush any of the larger pieces of raw material down to the correct size. And then it'll go through a second magnet separator where it'll remove any metal and then go up our skip hoist to the top of the furnace.
And then the next part of the tour is the furnace where we actually melt.
Yep.
All
right. That's where you'll actually see the melting and spinning process.
Let's go see that. The silos are in that building we just came from, and this lift system is bringing it over here where the melter is. Justin, it looks like we've got a reverse volcano behind me. What are we seeing there?
So basically what you see, so we have an online melting process here. So in the event that anything goes wrong with that production process, we can't just shut the furnace down.
Yep.
So what you're seeing here is our ability to go offline. It diverts that melt flow off of our spinners or our cotton candy machines and dumps it in this pit where it'll cool down and be pulled out by front end loaders, taken over to storage and later pulverized to be reused as a raw material.
So there's almost really no waste in your process. Any cut off in the process gets dropped in there again. This little cool piece of molten lava will get reused again.
Yep.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, so we try to reuse everything here from our water to our heat to the raw material itself. Top of the stairs, what we're seeing there is the melting furnace. So you see that stream of melt come out into our gutter troughs and be diverted to our spinners, which are essentially our carnival cotton candy machines. So it's simply just like that.
Yeah.
The fibers are spun with high speed and air pulls them off, and to the discernible eye, there's no difference.
And has anything happened between that and here?
So it's being sprayed with its resin and water, and then that web is just being conveyed by this large hamster wheel you're seeing.
Got
so
it.
It's just continuously moving with the line, pulling those webs off and releasing it into a single layer.
It seems so uniform as it comes out here. That's wild.
Yeah, and that's really a true show of a good operator up in the melting furnace. So they're controlling how that melt stream is hitting those spinners, and that's what produces such a beautiful quality web.
And then from here, I saw the machine that kind of spins it, or I don't know what the right term is.
So that'd be your pendulum.
So that's the pendulum.
Yeah,
okay, so the pendulum's down here.
Yep.
And then the pendulum is taking it to the line where you're going to ultimately make the different rock wool insulation products,
yeah,
right?
So at this point, across our product line, it's a very similar product. And the magic essentially is being made down here with the pendulum and our LHC, our low density device, where we're layering it and achieving that specific aerator density based on the custom.
So this raw material here could end up being fluffy insulation that's in a cavity, it's not fluffy, it's still pretty dense, or it could be like a really dense, high PSI comfort board.
Yep.
But it all starts right here with the same raw material.
Yep. And then based on our layering and our the weight of the actual layer itself, which is determined based on operator and recipe set point, we achieve the different products. All right, Matt, so here's what's happening here. The wool has been layered and created its pre-form. It'll pass into the inlet of the oven where it begins that curing process and fuses it together as a board.
Got it. And if this was comfort board, which is more dense, same product line, you're just changing the process of how you're doing it a little bit, right? It's still the same line.
Yeah, everything's made on the same line here at Ranson. So you would just see a thinner layer coming out here, but it would be in the same raw material, just essentially a different process on the same line.
That's so cool. Yep.
All right, Matt. So after the curing process that you just saw, it's now passed to our pressure drum, where we're slightly damaging the wool so it's not going to pre-compress and come through your customer's walls once you install it. And then it passes through our edge trim saws, where we cut that rough edge off, leaving that really nice straight edge, and then divide it into the lane, whether that be your 47 or 48 inch product lane.
And what happens to that rough edge and all the other random pieces of material?
So all the dust you see being captured by the hoods and that rough edge that's coming off is all being mulched down and conveyed to our waste house, where we'll use it to either blow back into the wool web up at the spinners, or melt in as a raw material, just like the rock it previously was.
Yeah, so there's really no waste in this entire
process. Yeah, we try to limit waste as much as possible. We can't say we're waste-free, but we're as good as you can get here at ROCKWOOL.
That's cool. And what's the light that I'm seeing on the tunnel down
here? The light you're seeing is the state-of-the-art marking laser that we use here at Rand Farm. And that is capable of printing across the entire length of the line, top and bottom, legitimately anything that we want.
That's cool.
Yep.
So that's where we're putting the R value on the bat.
Yeah, so you'll get your ROCKWOOL name
and the logo,
or your R value or comfort board, whatever it may be. That'll be etched onto the top of the wool with high powered laser for that machine there.
Super cool.
All right, Matt. So what you're seeing here is our high pressure water jet. So this is giving you that width cut. So the 15 and a quarter or 16 and a quarter you're used to on the job site. So here we're using high pressure water to slice right through this insulation.
How high pressure are we talking?
So it is capable of going up to 60,000 PSI. So quite the cutting power. Cuts through just about anything we put through. We only put insulation through it here though. So it blasts through and all that dust is captured by the water. And then it's conveyed off via screw to a collection tank where we drain the water and reuse the water back in our process. And the dried out material we use as a raw material, just like the rock it originally was.
Now, why is it on a slant?
So it's on the slant to ensure that straight cut. So the line's continuously moving underneath and it's cutting straight. If it cuts straight across, you would have a jagged cut.
Have an angle cut.
Yep, you'd have that angle cut. So with that predispositioned angle, it allows us to have that straight cut. So this is really the end of the process. So we've already melted the rock down, we've spun it into fibers, cut it into boards, and now we're packaging it into the packaging you would see at your job site. So as you can see, these finished stacks of bats are coming in through the end feed of the bagger, where they're being compressed down into this snout, and we're taking single cut bags and compressing it in, and it's just essentially popping off of that snout.
That's wild. So that's fully automated. There's nobody touching those bags.
Yeah, so the process is completely automated. Our technicians are here really to troubleshoot the process and to refill these rolls of bags.
And then after the bats are done here, what happens in the process?
So then they'll receive their product description labeling, whether that be inkjet or a paper label, and they'll go into the bundling and stacking process for the pallet.
And then to the warehouse for the trucks to pick them up.
Yep, so it'll go to our temporary storage in our warehouse and be loaded on a truck and onto your job site. So you'll see behind me here, the robot's gonna pick up those finished bundles, place them onto its pallet, it's gonna travel down, retrieve its straps, and go straight to the warehouse, and then eventually your job site.